morning, my dear students. In this video, I will be teaching you a new chapter, which is from class 11th NCERT, The Portrait of a Lady. And it is written by a very nice author who is, as we all know, Khushwant Singh. So let's start reading the chapter. First thing first is that it is a chapter in which you will know about how the love of grandparents and the love of children is important for children also and for grandparents also. They both are equally important for each other, and I wish that everybody shares a good bond with them, as that bond is very important in our lives. So let's start the chapter. So here the story is in first person. That means the narrator, or you can say the author, is describing it. So the first is, here is, my grandmother, like everybody's grandmother, was an old woman. So she is basically an old woman, as har kisi ki grandmother old hi hoti hai. So she is basically an old woman, and she has wrinkles on her face, and people had said that she had once young and pretty. Obviously everybody is once young and pretty, koi directly hamara old nahi ho jata hai. She also had a husband. Obviously if the narrator is there, it means the narrator is her grandson, so she is obviously having a husband, that is narrator's grandfather. So how his grandfather looked. Okay, so here is it described, my grandfather's portrait. Portrait is basically a picture, you can say, or a painting. The portrait hung above the mantelpiece in the drawing room. He wore a big turban and loose fitting clothes. His long white beard covered the best part of his chest, and he looked at least 100 years old. Yani ki wo bhi old hi lagte hain. He didn't like the sort of person who would have a wife or children. He looked as if he could only have lots and lots of grandchildren. As for my grandmother being young and pretty, the thought was almost revolting. She often told us of the games she used to play as a child. That seemed quite absurd and undignified on her part, and we treated it like the fables of the prophets she used to tell us. She had always been short and fat and slightly bent. Her face was a crisscross of wrinkles running from everywhere to everywhere. No, we were certain she had always been, as we had known her, old. So terribly old that she couldn't have grown older and had stayed the same age for 20 years. It's like he is saying, like, obviously when we see our grandmothers, we are so small that we see them while they are already old. Or when we grow up and we feel conscious to judge someone whether they are young or old, the grandmother grew older only, na? Our parents grew older. We become a child to from a child we become an adult, and then from an adult we grow old. So similarly, when we are becoming adult, when we are growing up, our parents and our grandparents grow older. They're not gonna go young like us. So she was always beautiful. Basically here he wants to say that she has a nice heart. It doesn't matter how her face looked, it doesn't matter about the height. What matters is she had a good heart, and that's the most important thing. Yeah. She hobbled about the house in the spotless white, with one hand resting on her waist to balance her stoop and the other telling the beads of her rosary. And her silver locks were scattered untidily over her pale, puckered face, and her lips constantly moved in inaudible prayer. Yeah, she was beautiful. She was like the winter landscape in the mountain, an expanse of pure white serenity, breathing peace and contentment. My grandmother and I were good friends. My parents left me with her when they went to live in the city, and we were constantly together. She used to wake me up in the morning and get me ready for school. She said a morning prayer in a monotonous sing-song while she bathed and dressed me, in the hope that I would listen and go it to my heart. I listened because I loved her voice, but never bothered to learn this. Obviously, sometimes we listen to something because we love the voice of the singer. Maybe we love the music. We don't listen to the lyrics most of the time. So that's what happened with the narrator as well. So then she would fetch my wooden slate, which she had already washed and plastered with. And so this is the story of earlier times when the narrator was too small. And narrator is today Khushwant Singh, if you say, is so old today. So at that time, they were having slates. Slates is basically a blackboard kind of thing, but it is a very compact, like you can put it in a bag and you can clean it every day. Then she would fetch my wooden slate, which she had already washed and plastered with yellow chalk, a tiny earthen ink pot, and red pen. Tie them all in a bundle and hand it to me. And after a breakfast of a thick stale chapati with a little butter and sugar spread on it, we went to school. She carried several stale chapatis with her for village dog, and my grandmother always went to school with me because the school was attached to the temple. The priest taught the alphabet and the morning prayer, while the children sat in rows on either side of the veranda, singing in the alphabet or prayer in the chorus, and my grandmother sat inside reading the scriptures. When we had both finished, we would both walk back together, and this time the village dogs would meet us at the temple door, and they followed us to our home, growling and fighting with each other with the chapatis we threw to them. When my parents were comfortably settled in the city, they sent for us. So now this is the turning point of the story of grandmother and her grandson's friendship. That is the grandmother and Khushwant Singh's friendship. Although we share the same room, my grandmother no longer came to school with me. I used to go to an English school in a motor bus, and there were no dogs on the street, and she took to feeding sparrows in the courtyard of our city house. As the years rolled by, we saw less of each other. For some time, she continued to wake me up and get me ready for school, and when I came back, she would ask me what the teacher had taught me. So here she used to ask him, but she couldn't understand. So she was basically a conservative person, and she liked that children should be taught like something about a God, but they were not teaching, which English schools doesn't do. We're teaching him Western science, learning the law of gravity, Archimedes' principle, the world being round, etc. So these things made her unhappy. She couldn't help with these lessons because she didn't believe in the things they taught at the English school and was distressed the things they taught. She was distressed that there was no teaching about God and the scriptures, as I told you before. One day I announced that we were being given music lessons, and she was very disturbed. To her, music had lewd associations, and it was the monopoly of harlots and beggar and not meant for gentle folk. She said nothing, but her silence means disapproval. She rarely talked to me after that. When I went to the university, I was given a room of my own. The common link of friendship was snapped. My grandmother accepted her seclusion with resignation, and she rarely left her spinning wheel to talk to anyone. She didn't talk to anyone. From sunrise to sunset, she sat by her wheel spinning and reciting prayers. Only in the afternoon she relaxed for a while to feed the sparrows, while she sat in the veranda breaking the bread into little bits. Hundreds of little birds collected round her, creating a veritable bedlam of chirrupings, and some came and perched on her legs, on her shoulders, some even sat on her head. She smiled but never shooed them away. It used to be the happiest half hour of the day for her. When I decided to go abroad for further studies, I was sure she would be upset. I would be away for 5 years, and at her age, one would never tell. But my grandmother could. She was not even sentimental. She came to leave me at the railway station, but didn't talk or show any emotion. Her lips were busy telling the beads of her rosary. Silently, she kissed my forehead, and when I cherished the moist imprint as perhaps the last sign of physical contact. That was not so. After 5 years, so here's the thing, that after 5 years, he has come back and was met by her at the station, and she didn't look a day older. She still had no time for words, and she clasped me in her arms, and I could hear her reciting her prayers. Even in the first year of my arrival, her happiest moments were with the sparrows, and she fed longer and frivolous rebukes. In the evening, a change came over her. She didn't pray. She collected the women of the neighborhood, got an old drum, and started to sing. For several hours, she thumped the sagging skins of the dilapidated drum and sang of the homecoming of warriors. We had to persuade her to stop to avoid. That was the first time I'd known her that she didn't pray. The next morning she was taken ill. It was a mild fever, and the doctor told us that it would go, but my grandmother thought differently. She told us that her end was near, and she said that since only a few hours before the close of the last chapter of her life, she had omitted to pray. She was not going to waste any more time. We protested, but she ignored. She lay peacefully in bed, praying and telling her beads. Even before we could suspect, her lips stopped moving and the rosary fell from her lifeless fingers. A peaceful pallor spread on her face and we knew that she was dead. We lifted her off the bed and, as customary, laid her on the ground and covered her with a red shroud. After a few hours of mourning, we left her alone to make arrangements for her funeral. In the evening, we went to her room with a crude stretcher to take her to be cremated. The sun was setting and had let her take her to be cremated with a blaze of golden light. We stopped halfway in the courtyard, all over the veranda and in her room, right up to where she lay dead, stiff wrapped in the red shroud. Thousands of sparrows sat scattered on the floor. There were no chirruping. We felt sorry for the birds, and my mother fetched some bread for them. She broke it into little crumbs the way my grandmother used to and threw it to them. The sparrows took no notice of the bread. When we carried my grandmother's corpse off, they flew away quietly. Next morning, the sweeper swept the breadcrumbs into the dustbin. So basically, the birds loved her. The birds knew her touch. The birds knew her smell, maybe. So the day she passed away, the birds also left the place. So this is a story. Thank you guys for your patience. Thank you for listening.